Hey, good morning, Greeneville campus. And good morning to everybody tuning in online. Glad that you are connecting with us as well. So I didn't know this, but I just heard this morning that I'm going to be giving a category-shattering sermon. So hold on, let me go get that one. Well, I am talking about John chapter 14, and I don't know if it's category-shattering, but we'll see. This is a very dense passage that we are talking about this morning. There's a lot in here. And so normally, I work my sermons to fit the time constraint that I'm given, and I usually don't go past, but I can guarantee you today, I'm going to be going past a little bit. There's a lot to go in here. But we all know Scott, and so comparatively, we're going to be just fine. So don't you worry. Don't you worry. We've got a lot to talk about, and there's actually a part of this section of Scripture that I have kind of flipped upside down on how I understand it and how I interpret it. And so when we talk about it, you know, it might even make you upset. It might make you angry. You might get up and you might leave. Okay, well, I hope not anyway. But we will see. We will see. But I do have some very interesting things that I want to say, and that's probably what he means by category shattering. So what we're going to do, so my sermon title is Whoever Has Seen Me Has Seen the Father. Because in our passage today, Jesus speaks very explicitly of his equality with God, his equality with the Father. And he very explicitly says that he is the only way to God. So, just like we always do, let me read the entire passage that we are going to be talking about so we have a bird's eye view, and I'll read that for you, and you follow along, okay? So turn with me, John 14, verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. And Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Let me pray for us, and then we will dig into verse 1 together. God, we are so thankful for Jesus. We are so thankful that while we were sinners, Christ came, he died for us, so that our sins can be washed away, so that we can take on his righteousness in order to be redeemed to you, to have a right relationship with you, so that we can have an intimate relationship with you, the Father. Help me to speak clearly. Help us to take your word so that it can edify us, change us, deform us into Christ-like figures. Thank you for your word. Amen. All right. As we get into this passage, we can't just jump in and start slicing and dicing. We've got to understand the context, because in all forms of literature, context is king. It is how you understand words. It's the context. If you are reading a personal letter, you've got to understand who wrote it. Who is it written to? Is it even written to you? Is it written to somebody else? Why are you reading someone else's mail? You've got to understand what's the context of their relationship. Are they enemies? Are they friends? Are they married? You have to understand maybe there's previous letters that are leading up to this one. Maybe you're reading government statement of law or policy, and you've got to understand that context. Which government is it? Does it apply to you? Or maybe your income means you're over here in this bracket, so then it doesn't apply to you. There's context to understanding that. Or maybe you're in history class and the note has passed by and the note says, I don't think we should. That's a terrible idea. And so then you're wondering, what is this idea? And who's going to do this? And is this going to be entertaining to watch, whatever is happening? So you've got to understand context, no matter what kind of literature it is. And the Bible is literature. And I know we say this on the stage a lot, and I know I mention it a lot when I preach, but it's because it's so vital. It's so true to understanding what the Bible is trying to say. God inspired the authors of Scripture in their particular setting. He inspired the authors to write to certain people in a certain historical context, in a certain historical line of God's relationship with them. And so for us to understand what God's intention was behind those specific words, we've got to understand the context. And if we take that scripture out of its context, then we are taking it out of its God-intended purposes, and we are putting our own purposes on it. Context is important. But at the same time, we're not perfect. Context is hard. Sometimes we get it wrong. So that's why we do this in community. That's why we study the Bible in community, because there are some people who just understand certain aspects of context better than others. And so we go to those people and we do this together. And we also have to approach this Bible study thing with humility, because sometimes we need corrected. I've had so much of my theology corrected and refined as I have strived to understand the Bible in community. So there's lots of different contexts that we can look at. We can look at the surrounding context. We can look at the general message of a book. We can look at the flow of thought. We can look at the history. We can look at the whole Bible message itself. All right? Lots of different contexts that we go to and say, how does this interpret? Help me interpret what's going on. So let's consider our narrative or story context for today's passage. John 14, John is writing about the night that Jesus is betrayed and arrested. We've been there for weeks, and we're going to be there for a few more chapters, but it is the night that, if you remember, Jesus has sent away Judas to betray him. He has told his disciples, hey, I'm going to leave, and you can't come with me. He told Peter, three times before tonight's over, you will deny me. And so tension is high. Emotions are high. Stress is high. Jesus is troubled even. He's thinking forward to his betrayal, the fact that he's going to be arrested, abandoned, persecuted, beaten, crucified, and killed. His disciples, who have had the hope of a Messiah, who's they've been waiting their entire lives, is here. He's about to leave. So what do they do? So now let's just pause for a second and consider the literary context. The book of John. Where's it at in the book of John? We are coming up into this section that Bible scholars like to call the farewell discourse. Starting right here, the next few chapters, they are the last words of Jesus. He is with his Jesus, with his disciples for the last night, and like these are the things they've got to get. Jesus is saying, he's touching on these things one last time. You've got to understand these things. And so where does Jesus start with his farewell discourse? He starts with his equality with God. He starts by exploring and expounding on the idea that he and the Father are one. Let's look at verse 1 together. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. So just as I said earlier, emotions are high. Everyone is stressed. The disciples don't know what to do. And so he doesn't want to leave them in that state. So he tells them, let not your hearts be troubled. But then what is the solution? If it's not trouble, what are they to turn to? Believe in God. Believe also in me. And so Jesus is saying, don't forget who your God is. Don't forget that you can have a confidence in a God who is sovereign. He's still in control, even though it's going to feel like your life is totally disrupted. God is still good. He still has the good of his children in mind, even though they're not sure where their Messiah is going, and things are kind of falling apart, it feels. But then Jesus extends that faith and says, have faith in God, have faith also in me. And he's equating the two. Just like you can have faith and confidence in God the Father, you can have that same confidence and faith in me. As in, Jesus is also sovereign and in control. Jesus is good and has the good of his children in mind. And then also, they can turn that around. And their experience with Jesus firsthand is experiencing that Jesus loves them, that Jesus has their good in mind, that Jesus teaches them God accurately. They can turn that around and understand God that way by understanding Jesus. And he'll talk more about that in a little bit. So then in the next few verses, he expounds on this command to believe in God and believe also in him. So let's look at verse 2. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. So you remember all those things I said about context and how they're really important? Well, here's a place where it is really important. It is really important to understand what Jesus is saying here. And specifically, I want us to consider the context of his phrase, my Father's house, and everything that he's saying about preparing it. Most people think that Jesus is saying here that he is going to heaven, he is going to where God dwells, and that he is preparing it for when we die. And then we go to heaven, and we have this place that he has prepared for us. But I want to provide some context to provide also an alternative interpretation. And just to let the cat out of the bag, I don't think Jesus is talking about heaven here. I don't think Jesus is talking about heaven. And I want to build a context of what I think he's talking about. So first, looking at this word room that he's saying that he is preparing. When you look at the root of what that means, it just means a dwelling place. He's going to prepare a dwelling place so that we can dwell with God, so God can dwell with us. Now let's consider his phrase, my Father's house. Jesus has used this phrase four different times that I could find. And so how does he use this phrase? The first place is in Luke 2:49. And so Jesus at this moment is a small child. His family comes to Jerusalem, and unfortunately Jesus gets left behind, and his family is going, and then they realize, oh no, we left our child behind, and it's the Son of God. We have to hurry and get back. So they come back, and they're looking all over for Jesus, and they don't find him until they arrive at the temple. And this is what Jesus says. Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house? So he's talking about the temple in Jerusalem on earth. Then, Jesus, a little bit later, Jesus is now fully grown. John 2:16, he's in his public ministry, preaching publicly, doing public things. And there are merchants in the temple. And he goes, and you know, these merchants are selling substandard sacrificial animals to the worshipers, and they're scamming them out of too much money for those things. And so, you know, this is where he makes the whip and cracks it and overturns tables and gets them out, right? So he's doing that, and Jesus says, and the verse says, and he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away, do not make my Father's house a house of trade. Again, talking about the temple in Jerusalem on earth. Then the next time it's used is when Jesus is telling a parable. And in the parable, there's a character, and that character uses the phrase, my Father's house. And he's referring to where his family dwells. A literal house, a figurative literal house, because it's a parable, so it's figurative. But it's a house on earth, and it's not a heavenly place. So now let's zoom back out, and let's look at the whole Bible message, okay? Let's look at what's happening in the bigger view. From the beginning of Scripture, we can trace this theme of God dwelling with his people from Genesis all the way through. Starting in Genesis, he creates man and woman. He makes them in his image. He creates a paradise, the Garden of Eden, and they dwell together there. God, Adam and Eve, on earth. So then we fast forward a little bit and we arrive at the tabernacle. God gives these commands, these instructions for building this tent of worship in the wilderness. And the tent is described, is decorated, is full of Garden of Eden imagery, of things that symbolically point to the creation week, that point to that paradise, that point the worshipers to this time when God and man dwelled together. Then going a little bit further, we see the same thing when the instructions for the temple is given. Again, full of Eden imagery, full of Eden symbolism. And then going to the second temple, the temple that Jesus interacted with, again, Eden imagery, Eden symbolism, pointing back to when God and man dwelt together on earth. And then if we keep going in the Old Testament Hebrew scriptures, we see the Old Testament prophets picking up this theme and understanding it very clearly. I've got several psalms that I want to read to you really quickly. And what I want you to listen for is their desire to dwell in the temple, in the house of God, not future tense when they die, but now on earth. Listen, Psalm 23:6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 26:8, O Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Psalm 27:4, one thing I have asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Psalm 65:4, blessed is the one you choose and bring near to dwell in your courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house, the holiness of your temple. Psalm 84:4, blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praise. Psalm 84:10, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. We see over and over how these worshipers of God, these poets of the Old Testament, understood the imagery of the temple of God. They understood that it was more than just a place for sacrifice. It was more than just a place to seek cleansing from leprosy and other things, but that it gave worshipers opportunity to be close with God, even if it was just momentarily. But what they desired was that for that to last and last and last all the days of their lives. And this isn't literal, because the temple wasn't that big. It wasn't big enough for just everybody to move in and live in the temple. There were some accounts in the Old Testament of a few folks who lived there, like the priests and stuff, but it wasn't possible for the nation of Israel to move into the temple. And so what they're expressing is their desire to be close with God, to have intimacy with him, to know him accurately, to be known by him, to be able to call out to God and know that he's there and that he's going to hear them. And the object and the place that represented this intimacy with God is the temple, the house of the Lord. That's where they wanted to be. And that's what I think Jesus is trying to say here. He's not trying to tell us that he's going to heaven to build us custom homes or custom rooms in just the way that Tyson wants, you know, with skateboards on the wall, I can take one down and go ride. But what Jesus is saying is that the work that he is leaving disciples to go and do, the cross, the redemptive work of the cross, will give his followers the opportunity to have intimacy with God now, daily, living in the temple, able to have that intimate relationship that you can only have when you live with somebody. God wants to dwell with us here and now on earth. And Jesus makes it happen. Because of the cross, it can happen. We are redeemed to God if you have faith that Christ has paid for your sin. And we can have that intimacy with him, just like Adam and Eve had back in the Garden of Eden. And one more verse to support this idea that Jesus is talking about us dwelling with God in intimacy now. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? The New Testament writers talk in several locations about the Spirit of God dwelling with us like a temple. Even the very next passage. So we're in John 14:1-14 now, the next section that we're going to be talking about next week. Jesus talks about the Spirit of God coming and dwelling in us, with us. And Jesus says, and I will come and be with you, like a temple. So, maybe you're following with me, and maybe you're thinking, okay, I get that, I see that, I agree. And maybe you're thinking, Tyson, you're crazy, he's talking about heaven, I'm not convinced, you're a heretic. And if so, that's all right. We can still be friends. But what I want to ask you is to do me a favor. Take this interpretation that I'm offering for a test drive. Just put it in your mind. Hold on to it while we go through the rest of the passage and see if it fits. See if it fits better than interpreting that Jesus is preparing some other place, all right? So let me summarize. This is the interpretation I want you to hold on to. That Jesus' preparations in his Father's house is a reference to the work of the cross, creating opportunity for us to have close and intimate relationship with God as if we're living in the temple, the dwelling place of God on earth. Okay? So let's pick it back up. Verse 4. And you know the way to where I'm going. Jesus, again, picking up this idea of going to prepare this place. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? So here Thomas is confused. He thinks Jesus is talking about going to a literal place, and he wants to go to that literal place. Then Jesus answers his confusion with a little bit more clarity. Verse 6, Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. So Thomas is thinking it's a literal place, that we're going to go and do something at a place. And to clarify, Jesus does not say, he does not clarify its location or the path or the time frame. Oh, I'm talking about heaven and future stuff, Thomas. Jesus clarifies by saying, you can know God. His clarification is, you can better know God by knowing me. But then Jesus exclaims, not only that, but he claims exclusivity to that path. We can only know God through Jesus. Jesus said in this last verse, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. But Tyson, I think that Jesus wasn't really being that exclusive Let's read it again. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. But Tyson, I think that if I am just a good enough person, if I just try my best, God will know my heart, that I'm doing my best. Let's read it again. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. But I think that just an earnest follower of the Muslim faith or any faith can know God. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. But Tyson, I just think that sounds really unfair. Well, I didn't say it. Jesus said it. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. But I think you can't get around it. Jesus very hard claims exclusivity to God. You don't get to God without Christ. And so you either believe it or you don't. You either are a follower of Christ or you're not. To be a follower of Christ means you believe what he says. It means that you believe what he says about himself. So then to say you're a Christian but not believe that he is exclusive means you're setting aside what Christ has said about himself and saying, no, you're wrong, Jesus. No, I don't believe that. Jesus himself claims exclusivity to God. So think about this. If Jesus is the same God as the Old Testament, if Jesus is equal with God, then he's the same God as the Old Testament, then of course, he's exclusive. In the Old Testament, God never approved the worship of any other god. God never gave sanction for other religions. God never said, worship me however you want and approve it, and then approved it. He never did that. The Old Testament guidelines for worship were strict. They were only for him. And so, of course, Christ is not going to leave that character trait behind. If Jesus is God, he is the only God, and you only know God the Father through Jesus Christ. As we continue in our passage, we see the disciple Philip understand this. He understands that Jesus is the way to God, but he still has some confusion. So let's read. Verse 8. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and you still don't know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Wow, what a request from Philip. Like, okay, I believe that you are the way to God. Now, show me God. Let's see it. No one else in Scripture has seen God outside of visions or representations. Even Moses, when he asked to see the Father, basically got turned down. The Bible scholar D.A. Carson has some great things to say about Philip's request. So let me read this quote for you. So Philip asks for direct access, as it were, an immediate display of God himself. He thus joins the queue of human beings through the ages who have rightly understood that there can be no higher experience, no greater good than seeing God as he is in unimaginable splendor and transcendent glory. Just a fun thought here. I'm sitting here and these like lights are like blaring at me and it's like, vision of God right up here. We have been made in his image, and however much we have defaced that image, we still yearn for the vision of God. Moses had begged, now show me your glory, but the most that he was allowed to glimpse was the trailing edge of the back of God's glory. The evangelist, what he means by that is John, the author John of our gospel, the evangelist has already made it clear in his prologue that however mitigated God's gracious self-disclosure was in formal times, in Jesus, he has made himself known definitively, gloriously, visibly. Jesus is the representation of the Father. When you experience Jesus, you experience God. Now, carrying on from verse 10, Jesus further explains this indivisibility he has with God the Father. Verse 10, "Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works." Jesus is trying to help Philip and the other disciples and us to understand this Trinitarian, relationship that he has with the Father. There is a clear indivisibility. You can't separate the two. The one is inside the other. Yet there is some separation. There is some distinction because Jesus submits to the Father. And he only does the works and says the words that the Father gives him. And then Jesus doesn't only explain this truth to Philip, to his disciples, to you and I, the future readers. He commands us to believe them. So he takes this question that he has asked Philip, and he turns it into a command. Verse 11, believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Or else, believe on account of the works themselves. So believe the words, believe the works. They're both from the Father. So then after talking about his words and works from the Father, Jesus shifts gears and he says something crazy. He says something crazy. Verse 12. "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do, because I'm going to the Father." So how could the disciples or the early Christians or you and I, how could we do the same works as Jesus? These same works that he is attributing to God himself, let alone do greater works than Jesus. Well, remember when we went to the Old Testament to get some context? Let's do that again. So this time we're going to zoom mentally all the way back again to Genesis, and we're going to look at what happened there. God creates man and woman, and he makes them into the image of God. And he gives them command to work the ground, to have dominion, and to co-rule with him. And so in that sinless state, they are doing the works of God. God has given them a job description, and they're doing it. They are doing the works of God as they co-rule with God. Then, of course, sin messes that up, and instead of doing the works of God, they turn and do the works that they want to do. And that is what is the perpetual problem of sin, is we doing our works, we doing what we want, what our hearts desire. But then, what Jesus does, what he does on the cross, is he redeems us back to a right relationship with God. He redeems us back to this place where Adam and Eve dwelt with God, co-ruled with God, the works of God working out through them, and we can be in that same place. So think of it, think this through with me, where Jesus is reestablishing this idea. If Jesus removes our sin, if his salvation has made us spiritually alive again, if we are redeemed back to God, then we can dwell with God. We can know God accurately, and he will know us accurately. We get to bear his image accurately. We get to do the works on God's behalf as we submit to him, as we follow him. But what does this mean to do his works? What does this mean? What works? And especially, why? What greater works? How? As you can hear, I'm confused. I don't even understand. So I was talking with Travis Chapman, our youth director, about this. And just, we were going back and forth trying to figure out what does this mean that we are going to do greater works than Jesus. And so he helped us kind of get to an answer with this question. He asked, what was Jesus' greatest work? It was the cross, right? His greatest work was the cross. He self-sacrificed. He gave up himself to pay for our sin so that we could know God, so that we could have a relationship with God. So then if we are going to do works like that, then it looks like us doing the same thing. Sacrificing ourselves, giving up our conveniences, our demands, so that others can know God, so that others can be disciples of Jesus Christ. And so you can never convince me that anything that I've done is greater than what Jesus has done. But the heart of the message is this: the great works that God wants to do through you, through me, if you're a follower of Jesus, is to show love through self-sacrifice so that others can know God. Let me say that one more time. The great works that God wants to do through us is to show love through self-sacrifice so that others can know God. So if those are the great works that God can do through us and wants to do through us, then how does that color the next two verses? Let's read them. Verse 13, whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. So let me just keep reading. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Okay, so if we follow Christ, and if we understand these things, that Jesus is the only one to the Father, only way to the Father, that we only know the Father if we know the Son, that Jesus makes it so that we can dwell with God, that the works of Jesus are the works of the Father, that when we follow Christ, we will do similar works, God will work through us, then what are we supposed to ask for? What are we supposed to ask for? What is Jesus asking us to ask for? Wealth? Happiness? Lack of persecution? World peace? Perfect health? Fame? Comfort? Control? Jesus didn't ask for any of those things. What did Jesus ask for? He asked for strength from the Father to glorify Him. He asked for strength and ability to follow God's will. He asked for strength to be able to go through that process of self-sacrifice so that you could be redeemed to God. That is what Jesus asked for. That is what we are to ask for. To know Jesus is to know the Father. He is the only way we can do so. His sacrifice on the cross allows us to dwell intimately with God. When we dwell with God, He will do great works through us, like He does through Christ. Self-sacrificial works that draw God's people to Himself. When we ask to be used this way, He will make it happen. He will use us. He will do His works through us. I've got three questions I want you to consider. We're going to think about for a few seconds. Question number one, do you believe that Jesus is the only way to the Father? Question number two, do you desire to know God intimately, to dwell with Him now? Question number three, are you willing to allow God to do great works through you? Let's think about those. Friends, let me pray for us. God, Your redemptive work has accomplished so much for us, so much more than we know, that we understand, But we are thankful that you do it without us having to understand all those details. We are thankful that while we were still sinners, you came, you died on the cross, so that we could have our sins forgiven, so that we could be redeemed to you, so that we can dwell with you, so that we do not have to be afraid of you knowing us and being condemned and being destroyed because of our sin, but we can take on the righteousness of Christ and dwell with you, and you with us. God, I pray that we would submit to your Spirit working in us, submit to your Word changing us, that we would be tools in your hand to do work that draw people to you, to draw your people to redemption. God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for salvation that we have no hopes of achieving by ourselves, but it is only through Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you.